Good morning. I am Cheryl Schrader, and I thoroughly enjoy being a member of the Indian Lake Community Church. And many, many, many years ago, I enjoyed being Pastor Jim's second grade teacher. On behalf of our church family, we welcome you to the Indian Lake Community Church. We are glad that you've come to worship our Lord Jesus Christ with us this day. At this time, we ask that you would silence all electronic devices and free yourselves of all distractions as we now begin to silently prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you. Heavenly Father, as we gather today, we ask you to be with us. Open our hearts and our minds and our eyes and our ears that we can hear you and feel your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Peace and blessings from our Lord Jesus Christ. We welcome everyone here this morning. Announcements that we have, we still have room for sign-ups for the Bible study that will begin in Lent. It'll begin on and during the weeks of Lent. You can call the church office and sign up for that. Also, the chili cook-off is February the 13th. There's sign-ups in the Holy Grounds room. And I know across the street, Jim was the only one last week at the beginning of the service, and I challenged people to step up because we don't want him winning at all, let me tell you, because we have to live with that for another whole year. So that's the 13th. Well, immediately following this service, you can go over and do a little bit of tasting and decide which one you think is the best. And then after the second service, they'll come in and taste, and then we will have... then we'll eat. And also, we have outside judges, so there'll be no cheating this year. So unless he gets to the judges first, and then there we go. So also, we're bringing in canned goods. If you don't want to bring in canned goods, you can give money towards the backpack program that supplies food for the kids at the elementary and middle school for weekends. We gather the food and they pass that out to the kids that do not have food just so that they can eat over the weekends. There are 78 students from the middle school and elementary that we pass out food to, so that's a lot of food. They give them three meals a day and snacks and juices and things to drink. So help us out. Also, chocolate covered strawberries are on sale as of tomorrow, so you can get your order in, go online, or you can stop into the coffee shop when you get your coffee and sign up, and then the pickup is Friday and Saturday before Valentine's Day. Also, Jim's going to talk about the meal train.
I'm just as surprised as you are. So we have a new service online. It's called the Meal Train. Tara's been working the bugs out. And so what this is, if you go online with the computer, you can go in and you can set up to take a meal to the youth. You can also sign up to bring donuts or treats for the Holy Grounds room before service. And then what we're going to do is, as people have needs, so if somebody is ill or if somebody has those types of situations, we can contact you. And then once we contact you, you can go online and you can reserve a spot and take a meal to that family then to help them out during that time. And so Tara's got it all set up. The details will be coming out. I think we're going to send a link out in the e-blast, so you can go in, just set up an account. It's quick and easy. Username, password, and then you're all set up. And if you're not able to do that, if the computer is not your thing, then we can also coordinate that through Becky in the church office. So thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, our prayer list today. We have Chuck Holman is still in OSU, Jan Dawson, Phil Berlin, Barb Krautwater, Karen Freimeyer has been in the hospital this week in Florida. With Ron Griffith, the family has been called in. We have Jean Mitchell, Mindy Munns. Kale Paxton is better today, but she still needs prayers. Mary Lou Ward. George Hosteller is Shar's uncle. Nora Myers is in the hospital. That's Bob's aunt. We have Jen Chrysler and Steve Petty both recovering from surgery, both doing okay, but still need prayers. We also have Ray Croissant and also Creighton Mullins, who is Larry Cassioli's grandpa. And we also have Dee Bissett is facing knee surgery tomorrow. The prayers for family and friends is for Nicole Vagatis and also Sandra Malley, Bob and Norma Kreitzer's daughter, and then Zach Taylor, Bob Easterday's grandson, died this week. Will you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we come to you just first of all to say thank you and to praise you and bring our glory to you. We come seeking your guidance and your strength. So many times you call us to do things that we feel inadequate or not capable of, but you, with you, all things are possible. So let us trust you and depend on the path you laid out for us. Heavenly Father, our list is long that we have mentioned, and many of us have other concerns, other people that are heavy on our heart today, and we lift them up silently to you at this time. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for hearing our prayers. Thank you for loving us as we are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you. Our call to worship today is from Psalm 71. God alone is our refuge and hope, our shelter and protection. God's love and compassion never fails. So come, lift your voices in praises to God. Bear witness to God's acts of mercy and love. Proclaim God's glory to all who will listen. Let's worship God together.
Today's first reading comes from Jeremiah 1, 4 through 10. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. Alas, sovereign Lord, I said, I do not know how to speak. I am too young. But the Lord said to me, do not say I am too young. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you to say. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord. Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth, and he said to me, I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." Second reading comes from 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 3. If I speak in tongues of men or angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I do not have faith that can move mountains, but I do not have love, I have nothing. If I give all the possessed to the poor and over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patience. Love is kind. And it does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will be passed away. For we know that in part we have prophecy in part. But when completeness comes, the what it is, the part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put away my childhood behind me. For now we see only the reflection in the mirror. Then we say we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even I am fully known. For now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love. This is the word of the Lord.
Friends.
For all the years that Judy was the organist and the pianist here, the funerals that she did with my father, the funerals she did with Karen, the funerals that I did with her, that was how she finished each one. And as we lost our church family every Sunday, then afterwards she would play that at the offertory. And every time BJ does that, it just pulls at my heartstrings thinking of all of our old friends that we've had here and those that we still have. So thank you, BJ. Our gospel lesson this morning, we are in the Gospel of St. Luke again, chapter 4, verses 21 through 30. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him, and he began by saying to them, "Today the scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself. Do here in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum.'" "I tell you the truth," he continued, "no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the sky was shut for 3.5 years, and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian." All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of the town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him down the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd, and he went on his way. This is the word of the Lord. So I was at a training seminar years ago, and the presenter of the seminar was really good. And during the breaks, he got to know all the participants pretty well. And so after we took a break one time and we came back together, he spoke to a younger man in the front, and he said to him, "Imagine you're in Chicago, and there's a skyscraper 30 stories up, and you're there. And across the road is the other skyscraper, 30 stories up, and there is a tight wire ran between the two buildings." He said, "Would you cross that tight wire?" He said, "No." He says, "What if I took $10,000 and I put it right in the center of that wire? Would you go?" I said, "No." He said, "What if I took $100,000 and I put it in the middle of that tight wire? Yours for the taking. Would you take it?" He said, "No." He got to $1 million. "Would you cross that and try and go across there to retrieve the $1 million? And he said, "No. Are you crazy?" And he said, "And what though if your son were trapped in the middle? Would you go?" And the man said, "Absolutely." And from that moment on, I thought that pretty much defines a version of love that we should have, the type of love that we should have, what we should love. Because we say that we love a lot of things, but the question is, push comes to shove, would you walk across that tightrope to retrieve it? We talk about cars, we talk about houses, families, we love this, we love that. We love tacos. We love bacon. I wouldn't go across crosswire for bacon, I can tell you that. That's not really love, okay? That's not the true love, the biblical love, the kind of love that we're talking about. Even romantic love, which is for our spouse or future spouse or what have you, that has its limits as well, because there are times when we are dating and we have that romantic love that we say and do things we regret. Seems like a good idea at the time. When I found out that Char's birthday was July the 4th, you know what I said to her? "That explains all the fireworks." Because I am smooth like that. But on her side, when we were dating, I had this bad habit. I used to smoke cigarettes. I smoked a pack a day. And one day we were talking in the evening, and she looked at me and she said, "You know, if only you would stop smoking, you would be perfect." Well, guess what? I quit smoking. 29 years now, I am perfection personified, you know? She has regrets in life, and that comment, I think, is right there at the top of the list. But it was romantic love, you know? It's based on attraction. It's based on emotion. But if it's going to last, if it's going to build, it has to become something stronger. I read this week the quote, and I thought this was good. "Romance is a dream, but marriage is the alarm clock." Because eventually, you have to move on to something more mundane if it's going to be meaningful. It takes a turn. It changes. It's still love, but it's not the same. and is something based on so much deeper and more respect and mutual admiration and support. And still, it is not the same as that love that God has for us. A man willing to walk on a tightrope to save his son. What does that say to you? That to me is a sacrificial love. That means that whatever is there, whatever we love, is worth dying for or risking the chance of dying for. It personifies the type of love that God has for us. And it's the type of love that he expects us to have for others. Think about the scripture. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. And we know that Jesus said that anyone in this life who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternity. What's our priority? What do we seek in this life? Do we seek our will? Do we seek his? Which do we love more, God or ourselves? That's a basic question. Which do we love, our own lives or God himself? Which means more to us? This is the type of love that he says that we are called to have. It means that we would willingly give up our life in service of him rather than turn from him and his way. Can we live with that? That is such a difficult choice. Forget tightropes. Forget walking on that kind of thing. The question is literally, could you pick up your cross and follow him? Because scripture says that that's what we're called to do. That choice, if it is so important to us, what is so important to us? What do we love enough that we would risk our own life to achieve? And it's not usually the things that we might think of. There was a millionaire who was throwing himself a 50th birthday party. And he had this huge party, and everybody was at his house. And there in his pool, he takes everybody over to the pool, and he says, look, there are three crocodiles in my pool. Anybody who is brave enough to swim from one end of the pool to the other with the crocodiles in there, I will give you anything you want. Just name it. Well, everybody, of course, looked around and said, that's crazy. I'm not going to even touch that. So the evening goes on, and they're having their party, and all of a sudden, there is a big splash. And they turn, and there is a man swimming the length of the pool. Jaws are snapping, and tails are flying. The water is flying, and he's swimming as fast as he can, and he gets to the And then he pulls himself up out of the pool and he falls down, and the millionaire comes over and says, that was incredible. I didn't think anybody would take that challenge. And I am true to my word. He says, I will give you anything you want. And the guy stood up and he said, well, let's start by finding out the name of whoever pushed me in. That would be the best place to start, because nobody in their right mind is going to swim the length of a pool and fight crocodiles for money or wealth, or any car or gift or anything that we might have. Think about the Old Testament prophets, okay? This is an example where they would boldly proclaim the word of God, come what may. Nothing could deter them. Regardless of the circumstances, regardless of the repercussions that they might have or the suffering they might endure, they would continue on. Jeremiah was just one of many of the Old Testament prophets that faced this. When he was called, he said, but I'm too young, I can't speak. And God says, don't say that. He says, because I'm counting on you. I knew you in your mother's womb. I have this mission for you. You are going to go, and you were going to proclaim my word. And so Jeremiah does. And in his lifetime, he knew what it was to be hated. He knew frustration because nobody listened to him. He knew rejection because everybody turned away from him. His own family hated him. He saw his own fellow prophets murdered. He was threatened. He saw his countrymen forget God and turn to the worship of idols. He saw his fellow people reject God himself. He saw his countrymen carried into exile, and he too was carried into exile eventually. And he wept. He wept for his nation. He wept for his countrymen. He wept so often and so much, his nickname was literally the weeping prophet. That was his life. That was his experience, called to serve God, and yet never changed his story. Never once went along to get along, never once went along with the crowd. He realized that the majority opinion was not necessarily God's will, and he was willing to stand up to risk or to lose his life in the service of God. He relied on the love of God to sustain him, and he loved God more than his own life. He was willing to give up his life in service because he loved God more than he loved his own life. And it brings back to the question, who do we love more, God or self? What are we seeking? Are we seeking truth Or are we seeking comfort in this world? C.S. Lewis is one of my favorite authors, and he wrote, "If you look for truth, you may find comfort in the end. If you look for comfort, you will not get either comfort or truth. Only soft soap and wishful thinking to begin with, and in the end, despair." What do we seek in this life, truth or comfort? Do the trappings of this life mean more to us than the mission that we are called to fulfill? Do you foolishly put trust in your own money and abilities and strength and wisdom and capabilities over those of God? Because too often we buy in. We buy in and we think that the things of this world will sustain us, that through our own power and through our own resources, we will be able to accomplish anything that we want. Well, guess what? Do you know what they call 20 millionaires watching the Super Bowl? The Cleveland Browns. Money, talent, ability, go all the way, or not. Now, you can throw about any team name in there. After today, who knows, you probably throw the Bengals in there. I don't know. But the idea is this: money, talent, ambition, goals, drive, obstacles. Once things arise, and once things get in our way, and once things challenge us, then all of the things that we rely on, all of our self-sustaining abilities that we think are so grand, they can fail us. And we have to come back again to the question, do we love this life? Do we love ourselves more than Him? Because to live as God calls us to live is to love as God calls us to love. It's agape love. It's unconditional love. I read a quote this week. It's the highest form of love, charity, and the love of God for man and man for God. And this love focuses on the outward rather than the inward. And according to 1 Timothy, it comes out of a pure heart and of a good conscience and of faith unfeigned. When it comes to love and the way we are called to love and the type of love and the godly love that we are to show to the world, Paul says it is the most excellent way. Now, for those of us who came of age in the 80s, every time I read that, I picture Paul in a tie-dyed tunic going, "Dude, it's the most excellent way. It's righteous." He probably didn't say it that way, but it'd be cool if he did, you know? 1 Corinthians 13. I believe there is a law in Ohio that makes it mandatory that you read that at every wedding, whether you want to or not. And that's fair enough. Because if couples love each other the way that 1 Corinthians calls us to love, if they loved everyone outside of themselves this way, then guess what? It would almost seem like the world would be the way that God intended it to be. Wouldn't that be something? Now, we know that Paul is speaking specifically about spiritual gifts. And yet this idea of love and this definition transfers to every aspect of our existence. Great faith, he says, acts of service, dedication, even miracle working power produce very little if it is self-serving, if it is about pride, and it is done without love. Translated into other words, if it's our jobs, our careers, our families, wealth, power, achievements, if all of that is focused inward and not outward, if we're only worried about ourselves and how we look and feel, then without love, it also produces very little. And Paul says, if we have not love, then we gain nothing. And conversely then, if we have love, then we gain everything. Faith, hope, and love. Those familiar words, everybody understands and knows the ending. Faith, hope, and love. Faith is the foundation and the content of God's message. Hope is the attitude and the focus that we have with this message. And love, though, love is the action. If we have faith and if we have hope and if we have love, then love is the action that we carry forward the faith and hope to a world in need. There were three friends that went deer hunting. There was a doctor, there was a lawyer, and there was a pastor. They come to the top of a hill and they all see the same buck. And simultaneously, they raise their guns and they shoot at the deer and the deer goes down. They scramble over there and once they get to the deer, they realize that there is only one bullet hole in the deer. And they begin to debate over who shot the deer and who should be able to claim the deer, who actually brought the deer down. And at that time, a game warden comes up and he's talking with them and they explain to him his dilemma and he says, "I will tell you who shot the deer. And he goes over and he looks at the deer and the one bullet hole, and he comes back and he says, "The pastor shot the deer." And they said, "How do you know?" And he said, "Because it went in one ear and out the other." Listen to me this morning, if you will. If you have never listened to me or concentrated on anything I have said in my entire life, if it goes in one ear and out the other, don't let today be that day. I want you to listen, and I want you to think about this, because this is the very foundation of who we are, what we do, and how we are to live, and how we are to love. Paul has shared with us the most excellent way. In the who, what, when, why, where, and how of the situation, we know that the who is all of us and all of God's children. The when is now and forever. We should do this. And the where is everywhere in God's green earth. So we have to determine the what. What do we love? The answer is we should love God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, and all of our mind, and our neighbors as ourselves. We have to value others and their well-being as much as our own. We have to have the type of love that Jeremiah had, that said no matter what the obstacles, the threats, no matter what was going on, that our love and our faith, our hope will be unwavering. Scripture says in Romans, Paul wrote, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardships or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered." Nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. Nothing should deter us from sharing that love in the world around us. So that's the what. We should love like God. We should love God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, and all of our mind, and our neighbors as ourselves. Why? Paul says, because it's the most excellent way and it never fails. It is the greatest commandment of all, is what Jesus told us. And one of the last things Jesus said to his disciples was to love one another as I have loved you. He said, this is how people will know that you are my followers. Not by the miracles that you will perform, the healings that you will do, the sermons that you will give, or anything else. They will know that you are my follower out of your acts of love. All of these things that we do out of love, they will know you are my followers. So then we come to how. How do we live this type of love? How do we examine this? How do we exemplify this type of love and the most excellent way to the world around us? And I was reading 1 Corinthians this week, and as I was reading it, I was thinking, how do you put this in practice? And then it occurred to me, 1 Corinthians 13, if you begin in verse 4 and you substitute for the word love, you substitute the word I, and you make this commitment as how we are to live and to love. And then it reads this way, I am patient, I am kind, I do not envy, I do not boast, I am not proud. I am not rude, I am not self-seeking, I am not easily angered, I keep no records of wrongs. I do not delight in evil, but rejoice with the truth. I will always protect, always trust, always hope, always persevere. Therefore, I will never fail. Eventually, as Paul says, we all have to put our childish ways behind us. We have to mature not just in our age, but we have to mature in our faith. We have to develop our faith, our hope, and our love, always recognizing that the demonstration of our faith and hope is how we love. That is why when he talks of the most excellent way, he is sure to assure us at the very end, with our actions, we show that. Faith, hope, and love. Therefore, the greatest of these is always love.
Jesus said, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Let us take time to prepare our hearts and together make our humble confession of sin to our Almighty God.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors. sinners as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who forgives all of our sins and cleanses us from all unrighteousness.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Jesus Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Ages, you have called your children to faith, to trust in your way. You have called your children to hope by being trustworthy to your promises. You have called your children to love through the example of our Savior Jesus Christ. As we break and eat this bread today, help mold us into a community that reflects the faith, hope, and love to which you have called us. Help us live in the bonds of love, the bonds of your Spirit. Amen.
God of the prophets, we come to this table knowing that it can be an uncomfortable place when we prefer to live for ourselves and for others just like us. You point out a hungry, suffering world and call us to love and serve it. When we prefer to feel good, you make our consciences hurt and twinge. As we drink this cup, help us remember that Christ drank the cup of suffering to free the world from sin's burden. By your Spirit, cure our self-imposed lack of vision and help us see what you would have us see, the living Christ who calls us to serve. Amen.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you had made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent your only and eternal Son, Jesus Christ, to share our human nature, to live and to die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will as a perfect sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. And on the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. For this is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Whenever you drink of this cup, do this in remembrance of me." And therefore we proclaim the mystery of the faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him.
and sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all of your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, our Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. We invite you now to come forward through the center aisle to receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ go with you and keep you now and forevermore. Amen.